Good morning. If you guys could please stand. Just want everybody to take a big, deep breath. It was a really rough week, but we serve an awesome God. I want to start with the Psalm of David, a time when David was discouraged and really desperate for the Lord. And I don't know about you, but I'm really desperate for the Lord today. And we should be every day. Psalm 63, it says, "You, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you, my whole being longs for you. In a dry and parched land where there is no water. I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. I will be fully satisfied as with the richest of foods. With singing lips, my mouth will praise you. On my bed, I remember you. I think of you through the watches of the night. Because you are my help, I sing in the shadow of your wings." Lord, we need you. I just praise you, Lord. Thank you, God, for coming and being here with us. Thank you for Jesus. We are so in need of you. Thank you for being our good shepherd. Help us to hear your voice, Lord, today. Fill us with your love. Pour your mercy and your grace upon us, Lord. And I just pray, Holy Spirit, that you come and that you invade and that you shake these walls and that you encourage your children. This is the air I breathe. Satisfy us with your word today. Strengthen us, Lord. Especially the Whitmer family, Lord. We lay them at your feet. We love you. We just praise you, God. In Jesus' name.
I'm desperate for you. powerful psalm, Psalm 51. It goes along with the psalm that Marion read earlier, Psalm 63. It's a powerful psalm of David at a very difficult time in his life. Listen to the word of God. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you are right in your verdict and justified when you judge. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. You desired faithfulness even in the womb. You taught me wisdom in the secret place. Cleanse me with hyssop and I will be clean. Wash me and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear your joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. The word of the Lord.
Darkness, open
to your children. You are good. Oh, yes. We pray this in your Son's precious and holy name. Amen. You may be seated.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, as we continue our worship this morning by the giving of our tithes and offering, Lord, we just ask that you would multiply the portion that we're giving back to you, Lord, that it would be used to further your kingdom here on this earth, Lord. Lord, we just thank you and praise you for the blessings that you've given to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Just a couple quick brief announcements this morning. The annual meeting that was for last night has been rescheduled for Saturday, February 11th at 6:30. Can't encourage enough everyone to please be in attendance at that meeting. It's very important. We only have this annual meeting once a year, so we do encourage everyone to please come out, make your schedules available, cancel what you have, and be there for this meeting on Saturday, February 11th at 6:30. Also, this upcoming Wednesday night, we have the Atlantic City Rescue Mission, the first Wednesday of the month. Anyone is welcome to come. It's a wonderful time, a ministry of opportunity to really reach those that don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. So we encourage you, if you have any questions, please see Jim Jensen. You can also talk to myself. Once again, this Wednesday night at 7:30 at the Atlantic City Rescue Mission. Thank you.
Children may be dismissed, and we are asking and allowing any children 11 years and younger may go downstairs. We are going to have to cover a very difficult topic today, and we're going to be talking about death, we're going to be talking about suicide, and so we want to make it available for anyone. I want to give you kind of a heads up as to what we are going to be sharing today. So if there's anybody who it's going to hit a little too close to home, please don't hesitate to step out into the foyer. This is an incredibly difficult thing to do, a very difficult time for all of us. It's with a really heavy heart that I'm here today. I'm excited to be here because I love Trinity. But on Tuesday night, Eric and Sherry's son, Jonathan, ended his own life, and we need to talk about that together as a congregation. But before we do, I'm going to ask Jenna to come up, and she has a few things she would like to share. She's going to pray for the Whitmers, and then we will dive in. But before we do, I just want to thank you guys for the time of rest that we were able to get. It was well rested. It may not sound like it in my voice, but when you've been running at a heavy clip and you suddenly get good rest, your body usually kind of quits on you. And so I just got like a bronchitis, laryngitis thing. So, but that's the least of what we have. But we want to thank you guys. It has been a very restful and awesome time. But we came back because we need to help walk the church through this. And thank you. Will you pray for us?
Yeah. Yeah, let's pray. Holy Spirit, we're grateful that you are here with us and that we're not going to talk or sing or listen today without you. And we're not going to go through the next days and weeks and months without you. We never do. And I pray that you would clear our minds and our hearts to be able to hear you, to receive you, to make more room for you. Jesus, it's very apparent that we either get to be devoured or we get to be consumed. And as a church body, we want to be consumed by the power and the goodness of God. We do not want to be devoured by the enemy. Because of Jesus, because of what you've done for us, Jesus, that is our birthright. That is who we belong to. That is our inheritance. That is our victory, and that is our resurrection. That we get to be consumed by a Father God who loves us and who is glorified within us as individuals and as a collective body. So we submit ourselves to you, Jesus, in ways you're going to bring them to our attention tonight, God. You're going to bring things to our mind and our heart, emotions and thoughts, and we're just going to say collectively as a group that we bring them and we offer them to you in submission to your authority and to your will and to your words, because you are good and you are kind and you are worthy. And we will not rise up anything above you. We will not place it higher. And we will not hide from you either, Jesus. We will not pretend to be better than we are or worse than we are. We will let you look at us. We will let you judge us. We will let you speak to us. We will let you love us. And we will receive from you the truth of the goodness of God. Be with our conversations, Jesus, our questions, our uncertainties, our fears. Let what is in darkness be brought to light, into the light of you. We are children of, it says in Thessalonians, we are not the children of darkness, we're the children of light. And we live in the light. And you are the light. And we're so grateful. We do lift up the entire Whitmer family. Such an important part of our congregation, and so dearly loved by all of us. And there is not one thing we can do as human beings to undo what has been done. And there is not one thing that we can do to anticipate and meet all their needs in the future, or even today. But you are with them and you are there and present. We pray that your presence would be overwhelming. We pray that you would meet every need even before they anticipate it, that they would come to you over and over and over again. And we ask that out of death you would bring life and you would bring resurrection, Jesus. And we love you. And we're grateful for you when we pray all these things in your most powerful name, the name of Jesus. Amen.
So, it is a very heavy, heavy subject and a very heavy time to be here. I want to begin by reading out of 1 Peter. And I think we need to understand kind of what is happening in our lives and in things that are going on. We're going to cover some of the myths of suicide. We're going to talk about some of the things that we need to walk together through, and how do we heal as a congregation, and how do we heal and walk the Whitmer family through this. And we're going to be talking about a word called lament, and we will be getting into that towards the end. But I want you to allow yourself to start thinking. I always thought lament was part of like a liturgical theology and understanding. And over the course of this week, I want to walk you through what it truly means to lament. So do me a favor, turn in your Bibles to 1 Peter, and we're going to look at 1 Peter chapter 5. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8 says this: "Be alert and sober-minded. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, stand firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of suffering." I want you to not be lost on that phrase, that the enemy is looking to devour. At 3 o'clock this morning, I got a text message from Marion saying that they had to take James to the hospital because he has 104 fever. Dan was supposed to preach today. Marion led worship. They were really close to Jonathan. It has already been a rough week, and you could tell Satan knew they were weak, and he went after their weakest point, bringing up memories and things in them that are just not fair. And the enemy was looking to devour. That was the first thing I thought of when I read that text. I said, anyone else could have texted me, and it would have been less obvious. But it was obvious that what the enemy is trying to do. He is looking to devour. And it's not because he cares about you or me. It's to destroy the name of God and to take away the glory of the knowledge of God. And so that is what we today are discussing. When we talk about suicide, it is a devouring. It is a devouring of our heart and our soul and our mind and our bodies. And when we talk about these things, we need to understand where this is coming from. That it is the enemy's attack, that he is coming to devour. And if we think that we aren't in a spiritual battle, then he's already got you where he wants you to be. It says in Galatians, what? Our battle is not against flesh and blood, but our battle is against what? The powers and principalities of this dark world. That we have, that Satan is out there to devour, that he is prowling around like a lion looking to destroy. It's not fair. But that's what he is coming to do. And he's looking to do that. And he devours us in different ways. And every person in here knows the bite of that lion. But we don't have to stand for it. We don't have to stand in it. The rest of the verse in Galatians says, then you know what? Stand up, take on the full armor of God, so that in the day of evil, you, after everything has been done, you may be able to stand. And he starts off by saying, take the belt of truth and gird it around your waist. Take truth and put it everywhere. Do you know why he starts with truth? Because you are only devoured by one thing, and that is deception. We are devoured by lies. In the Lord's Prayer, Jesus teaches us to pray in Matthew. He says, I teach you to pray, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. But we have this one phrase in there we all skip over. We kind of ignore it. We love the part where it says, give us today our daily bread and forgive others as we forgive them. And we go all of those other places. But the part where he says, and deliver us from the evil one. The word literally translated is deliver us from the deceiver. Deliver us from the one who deceives. Deliver us from the deceit that is coming. And that is what we need to stand on. We need to stand on, and we need to understand that there is this devourer that is coming, but it is lies. And as we give in to these lies, and as we allow these lies to come and to circulate inside of us, we give the enemy room to devour. But here in Peter, he tells you how to deal with this. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. You give him truth. You fight him with the word of God, and he will flee from you. When Jesus was tempted in the desert, it doesn't mean that you will not be tempted. It means it will come. Jesus was tempted in the desert. What did he use? The word of God and truth. Let me dispel one of the questions as we are going to talk about how do we minister to the family and to one another as a congregation. One of the things that we need to understand is we need to bring into light what we've allowed in the shadows for too long. Suicide is never talked about very much in anybody's circles, let alone from up front in a church. And when we do, we're afraid and we are terrified to talk about it because we don't have a good theology of it. I don't know where I learned it. I don't know where it came from. But I always believed that once you commit suicide, it is the unforgivable sin. I have dealt with suicide as a pastor way more often than I should. I've talked with people who have thought about it, who've had those intrusive thoughts. And you know what I'm talking about. You have these intrusive thoughts that come in and they get hold. I've dealt with people who have committed suicide but have not succeeded. And I've also done way too many funerals because of it. And so I have searched deep and wide as to where does Scripture actually talk about when we take our own lives that it is the unforgivable sin. It's not in there. It is something that we as church leaders want to kind of keep out there so that we can make sure that is the last thing you think of, that it's something as a deterrent. I want your deterrent to be that you are being lied to and it is not what you want to fall for. But I don't want you to be deterred because of something that is not true. On the contrary, Scripture says this: neither height nor depth nor angels nor demons nor anything in all of creation can separate you from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. Okay, that is a very powerful verse, and it leaves no room for anything to separate me from him. Why? Because it's not my hand that brought me to him. It was his hand that reached down and grabbed me. I cannot take me out of it. Praise God. And so as I look, I begin to see my theology of sin and my theology of a Savior who has come and separated me as far as the east is from the west from my sin does not mix with that mentality that my final act is what I am judged on. What if I was driving and I had committed a sin? I was angry at someone. I'll pick Steve. I don't know why I'm angry at Steve, but I'm angry at Steve. And you know what I'm angry at? I'm going to be angry at Mike, because you started a saxophone player while I was gone. You added saxophone. You waited until I left to be like, yeah, I play sax. So I have anger and hatred in my heart. Today was his first day. See, you tried to do it without me. But I'm angry with him in my heart. I have sinned against him in my heart, and I die in a car accident. Am I forgiven? I didn't have an opportunity to repent from that. I know I'm forgiven because Jesus' blood covers all sin, all of my sin. For those who believe in him and trust in him as their Savior, your sins are forgiven. By no means does this give permission to say, oh, okay, suicide then is okay and good. It is a mistrust of God. It is a falling for a lie instead of holding on to truth. It is a sin that allows God's enemies to blaspheme his name, as any sin is in our lives. That comes from David when he committed adultery with Bathsheba and then had Uriah murdered and all of that. Nathan comes to him and says, you have given God's enemies reason to blaspheme his name. That's what happens every time we sin. And suicide has a way of rippling around and has a way of getting even deeper in to the lies that other people have, where Satan will then have even more of a foothold to dig deeper into people's lives. The devastation that it brings into a family is second to none. For those of you who grieve, I'm not taking away your grief from loss that happened too soon, loss that happened, but suicide has an extra burn and sting attached to it. And a lot more lies that come for those who are the loved ones that are left. We are convinced when we commit suicide, we are convinced that it's not going to wound anyone as deep as it does. But it does, and it wounds deeper than any other loss. Not to preclude any loss, because I know the sting of that, and I know how that hurts. But as we go to minister to Eric and Sherry and to the Whitmer family and to one another in this, we have to understand there's a lot of questions, there's a lot of fear, there's a lot of anger that gets attached to this. And what we have to understand, first and foremost, is that our God is still God. That he has not somehow left us. It was an action of an irrational mind caught in deception. Have you ever been deceived by Satan? Have you ever fallen into his? Yes, we all have. This one was just more devastating to all of us around you. This one is so much more permanent. So we are trapped. But I want to take the sting out of it for those who are sitting there saying, how do I minister to them when they don't even know where their son is? I can tell you, I know where Jonathan is. He loved the Lord. He knew Jesus. Did he struggle? Yes. Do we all struggle? Yeah. But I want to stand firm and be able to say, okay, our God is still God. Let me walk you through how do we minister to them this week. One, we're going to need to give them space. They're going to need space to mourn and to process. We will have a morbid curiosity of, of what all happened. You know what happened. They lost their son. They lost a brother. They lost a grandson. They lost a nephew. We've lost a friend. We've lost a brother. We don't need any more. We don't need to delve into the lies that Satan has to try to figure out the puzzle pieces of deception. We just know where it came from, and he was devoured. And we need to know that we need to guard ourselves more today than yesterday. Actually, that's not true. We know we need to guard ourselves more now than ever. We've always had to guard ourselves. We don't need God more today than we did yesterday. We just know we need him more today than we did yesterday. And so we need to minister to them knowing that there are all of these questions that are rolling around in their hearts and in their minds, and you can't answer them. You can love, and we can care, and we can hold, and we can pray, and we can gather, and we can praise our Lord. But I will tell you, one of the most amazing things happened. I was driving Eric and Sherry to the funeral home to make arrangements. I guess that was Thursday or Friday. Friday, probably. All the days run together. I was driving them there, and I turned. The two of them were sitting in the back seat. I was driving because Eric didn't have the strength to drive. And I turned to them, and I said, I just want to tell you something. I know it's going to be a little bit out of place, but I've heard some rumblings that have happened in the church, and I need to tell you some amazing things that have happened. Marie and Tony got married that day. I want to celebrate that. We'll get to that in a minute. Hold on. Let me finish my story, then we'll celebrate and clap. I said that to them. Eric and Sherry cried tears of joy in the back seat of that car, and they said, you have made our day. Why? Because we can cry together, but we also need to celebrate together. We didn't all just suddenly get stuck in a pit. We're not in a pit as a church together. We are in life together with one another. We will cry with Eric and Sherry. We will cry with one another because we are hurt. We will cry with each other, but we will rejoice. We will rejoice in the amazing things that God is doing in the lives of people. And so, yes, let's clap and celebrate together what God has done with Marie and Tony. Praise you, Father. Yes, you can clap. And I bring that up so that you understand that we need this emotional roller coaster we're going to be on for the next couple weeks. We need to buckle up. There's going to be some amazing things, and we need to keep our eyes on who God is and what he's doing. Because what sorrow is meant to do is to take your eyes off of him. And what the enemy is trying to do is he's still trying to devour. He's not done. It's not just that Jonathan is now gone and he will leave us alone. He will now pick where the weaknesses are. And so we have to stand up together and be able to say, God, I see your goodness. I see your goodness here. And I need to keep my eyes on your goodness. I love that we kept singing that song. I didn't want to stop singing, You Are Good. I almost said, Marion, keep going. We'll just do this for an hour. You are good. You are so good. It's when we take our eyes off of that that we have fallen for the deceit of the enemy. That is when you become devoured, like Jenna was saying. You can either be devoured by him or consumed by the consuming fire that is the love of Jesus Christ and our God. I choose to be consumed by him, overwhelmed by his love, than to be devoured by sorrow. So let me ask you, how do we mourn? So many of us have lost so recently. There's so much mourning going on. How do you mourn? Turn in your Bibles to Psalm 13. And I want to change the word mourning to lamenting. I want to change the word sorrow so that we understand what lamenting is truly about. This is the Psalm 13, a Psalm of David. He wrote this for the director of music. Listen to how he starts off. He says, Will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? Oh, this is a psalm. This is in the Bible. This is David, one of the people that God says, you are a friend of mine. This is David being brutally honest to who? God. The first thing you have to understand is that sorrow makes us self-focused. To truly grieve and to truly lament, we need to be God-focused. And it can be from the depths and despair inside of our heart, but it has to be centered on him. We lose sight when we fall into sorrow and we make it about us. And David starts it off by saying, okay, God, this is how I've made it about me. I don't see you. Have you forgotten me? Are you going to hide your face from me forever? I love how he says the next phrase. How long must I wrestle with my thoughts? Day after day, I have sorrow in my heart. Day after day, I have sorrow in my heart. Is this not an incredible picture of grieving? We feel as if God is so far from us because he won't answer us and take away that pain. So how long have you forgotten me, God? How long is this going to last? And you hear him. This is not an accusation of God. This is an honesty of his spirit. So first of all, he comes to God in his throne room. He does not drag God into his room. And he is honest with him. And he brings honesty of how he feels. Now understand, he knows this is how he feels. He understands reality is something different. We need to separate our feelings from what is really reality. Because when we follow our feelings is when we can be deceived by the enemy so fast. And he says, and he continues on. He says, how long will my enemy triumph over me? How long is this deceit going to keep coming? How long is my heart going to be full of sorrow? Day after day, I have to wrestle with my thoughts. And then comes his plead. So he brings his case to the Lord, and he says, this is how I feel. This is where I am. God, this is where I am on the map. And it's okay to point out to God, this is where I am. God's not afraid of that. Because we need to know where we are on the map if we're going to know where we're going to go. If we're going to find out who we're supposed to be, we need to be honest with where we are on the map today. And David starts off by coming to God and showing God where he is. And this is his plead. Look on me and answer me, Lord my God. Give light to my eyes, or I will sleep in death. He's saying, I'm not going to make it without your light in my life. And my enemy will say, I have overcome him. Does it sound like what the enemy's done? And my foes will rejoice when I fall. You hear the despair that is in him. If that was how the psalm ended, that would be where most of us are. We have no problem going to the Lord and saying, this is where I am. This is the hurt that I have. Would you just come and would you answer me? But this is the difference between sorrow and a lament. Listen to what he finishes with. But I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation. I will sing the Lord's praises, for he has been good to me. Doesn't sorrow strip us of all of the good? So that we have such a hard time remembering how faithful and good God was. If I had somebody who had passed, I don't want to remember them because it hurts. But I forget then all of the amazing things that God gave me in that person. Because I try to tuck it away. Because I don't want to hurt anymore. And he's saying, no, we need to keep our eyes on that which is good. We need to understand that God has been good to us, and we have to choose to trust him when we don't feel we can. Big difference. Do you understand that? Let's follow that one again. We must choose to trust him when the deceiver has come to tell you you can't. It is time to choose to trust him. It is a conscious choice. And if we come before the Lord saying, God, I'm choosing to trust you, then we are bringing glory and honor to his name. And we can lament and we can walk through this well. All mourning, all hurt, and all sorrow. God is not afraid. He doesn't want us to keep any of this in the dark. He doesn't want us to keep in the dark the thoughts that we have of ending our lives. And I will tell you this today. You need to turn on the light switch wherever you have allowed darkness to reign. Let light in. Put it on the table. That is what he's doing here. If David had not brought this to the Lord, then it stays in darkness. And that which is what is in the shadows is what the enemy uses to devour. If we take these things and we put them in the light, the enemy has no room to devour. Because God's truth can shine on it. The belt of truth can be put around us that we will not be devoured, that we will not be exposed, and we will not be put to shame. Why? Because we have his truth. So my challenge to you is this. It's going to be a lot of challenges today. My challenge to you is this. First, understand you are trying to be devoured. Know the enemy is there. There is a lion in the room. Lord, deliver us from the evil one. That needs to be our prayer daily. As much as we say, Lord, give me today my daily bread. Lord, deliver me from the mouth of this lion, the deceiver. I need to be on guard for the deceit that is there. And I need to give no room in the darkness for him to move. So my challenge number one is bring to light that which is in darkness. If you have thoughts of suicide, bring them to light. Share it, that we might pray with one another and that you may be healed. It is not something that is wrong with you. It is not something that you are then failing at. It is not something that says you are broken. It is not something that says that you are somehow an alien to the rest of us. Every person here has intrusive thoughts that come after us. Satan is looking for something to attach it to so that it sticks. And we need to put that on the table. And we need to put that out there and say, I am not alone in this. These things have come. Will you pray with me and will you walk me through? And what does God do when we do those things? We bring it to the light. It's us putting the map on the table and saying, this is where I am. And we need to do that with one another. And we'll have time at the end of this service to come. Shannon has volunteered to sit with anybody who needs Shannon. If you want to just raise your hand. She has dealt with and has been a counselor for suicide, for victims, for family members. She has made herself available to anyone who needs to reach out to her. So please, she will be in the foyer after the service. If you want to be discreet about it, write your number, put it on a note, and just walk up and stick it in her hand and walk away. Or come and sit and talk with her. At the end of the service, we will be up here praying with one another, but there is stuff in this room that needs to be brought out to light. There is abuse that has happened to you that you've allowed in darkness for too long, and that darkness the enemy is using. Let's start walking together, that we might no longer have to be alone in any of this. I want to give you permission. It's okay to not be okay. There is no one in this room today who is okay. I look like I'm holding it all together, but don't ask me a week from now how I'm doing. It won't be real good. God has given me grace to get through the service on Wednesday and Thursday. And I'll tell you when that all is afterwards. But God is just graceful to me during these times to give me the strength to do this. But am I okay? I'm not okay. I'm not okay. I've seen too much death, and it has hurt so deeply. Every death that you have that you're carrying, I'm carrying as well. I have loved you and your family. So we're not okay. But if we just hold that in, Satan has room to use to devour one another. If we ever needed the family of God, it is today. Oh, I said that again, and it's wrong. If we ever knew we needed the family of God, it is today. I have needed you all along. I just don't always recognize it. So let's hold one another up. Let's pray for one another. Let's come together as the body and hold them up. This is not the end of Eric and Sherry. This is not the end of the Whitmer family. It is a difference that's going to happen. Their lives are not going to be the same. But we are going to be here with them. And they will continue to minister to us as we continue to minister to them. I wanted to broach an incredibly difficult subject, and I hope today there's some room to breathe. for all of you. There's room to be able to say, okay, I can handle this not by myself. I'm not alone in this, and I am loved. If you are new here, you may have been here for the past month, and I haven't known because I've been on sabbatical. But if you're new here, we want to welcome you to the family. You're part of this. This is not just for people who've been here for 30 years or more. We're a family walking through this together. We will use our gifts and our talents and our love for one another to walk each other through it. One of the things that can be the most healing is our time together and sharing the God stories and the good things that God is doing. Like I said, what brought and started healing on the way to the funeral home, when they're at their darkest, they were praising God because of something that was going on in other people's lives. God is good. Let me read the last part of Psalm 13 again. Because the other part we get, the other part we know how to do. We've done this 1,000 times, but maybe we haven't gone before the Lord to do this. But now I'm going to be focused and centered on Him, and I'm going to come to Him, and I'm going to trust. But I trust, I choose to trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation, and I will sing the Lord's praise, for He has been good to me. If you cannot get yourself to that point because you keep sitting back and your eyes are so focused on the sorrow, we will need each other to grab each other and to be able to say, no, God is good. Let me pray with you through this. We need each other desperately in this. Let's pray and walk each other through. Our God is an awesome God. He is a consuming fire that has each one of us. So if you are struggling in anything, I promise you, you are not struggling alone. Come at the end of the service and come up front and we will pray with you. I have prepared a small army to come and to pray. They know they're expecting you. And we're going to pray for one another. We're going to pray for healing. We're going to praise God for healing. If you have good things that God is doing, stand up and let's start praising Him. We're going to need testimony. We're going to need to share what God is doing because we need one another. Our God is an amazing and awesome God. Do not fall for the lies alone. Do not allow the lies in the darkness and stand alone. We are a family together. Call us. Call on each other. So one thing I've loved since I was on sabbatical, I've heard time and time again of people who've called other people in the congregation because they could not call me. Good. I'm not the end all be all. Call one another, love on one another, share with one another, and pray for each other that you might be healed. It doesn't say pray for each other that your pastor may come in and heal you. I have no healing powers or else I'd have a voice right now. My God is a consuming fire, and He adores you, and He loves you, and you are His child. Isaiah 43, my favorite verse, and I use it every sermon. What does it say? The Lord who created you, the Lord who formed you, says this, do not be afraid. For I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you walk through the waters, what's going to happen? They won't wash over you. How many of you feel like the waves of sorrow have washed over you and swept you away? The waves of sorrow will not do that if we mourn together. If we are holding one another, and if we are, our eyes are focused on Him. Do not allow sorrow to take your eyes off of who He is. Do not allow a scare at 3 o'clock in the morning to take your eyes off of how good He is. Keep singing, you are good, You are good. Because he is so good to us. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, what a God you are. A God who continues to move. A God who continues to love. And a God who has not left us alone. Father, I pray for anyone here who's holding things in darkness. Lord, that darkness is not dark to you. Psalm 139 says, I can go and I can hide in the darkness, but the darkness is as light to you. Lord, you have searched us and you know us. You know our anxious thoughts. You know the things we hide from you and we hide in the darkness. Lord, bring them to light, that we may no longer be devoured by the enemy, but that we might be consumed by the God of love. You are so good to us. Open our eyes to know you more. Father, I pray that you would help the Whitmers lament. I pray that you would help them mourn and that you would comfort them. That, Father, you would strengthen them with a strength that only you can provide. That you would guard their heart and minds with a peace that only you provide. Father, I thank you for your love. You are so good to your children. We praise you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Please stand. So the last song we're going to be singing is kind of a twist on a hymn called Be Still My Soul. And Be Still My Soul was written about 150 years ago by a German lady. And I love the words. It brings me comfort every time I listen and I sing to it. But this the song that we're going to be singing this morning is two stanzas shy. So I wanted to read the last two stanzas because I love them. It says, be still my soul when dearest friends depart and all is darkened in the veil of tears. Then shalt thou better know his love, his heart, who come to soothe thy sorrow and thy fears. Be still my soul, thy Jesus can repay. From his own fondness all he takes away. Be still my soul, begin the song of praise. On earth believing to thy Lord on high. Acknowledge him in all thy words and ways. So shall he view thee with a well-pleased eye. Be still my soul, the sun of life divine. Through passing clouds shall but more brightly shine. So if you guys don't know the song, please just listen and be blessed.
Thank you.
be seated. We have just a few other things that we would like to cover and do this morning. One, we've talked about the life of a church. One of the hardest things when you lose someone is to go outside and see the world continues on. It's a very odd feeling for any of those who have lost anyone. And it's hard as a church for us to say, okay, there are things that we're going to celebrate. There are things that we're going to do. There are things that we're going to enjoy and we're going to celebrate together, even though there are so many of us who are hurting at the same time. You can focus on more than one thing because life is full. It is not just one issue that is right in front of you at a time. One of the things that we're going to celebrate, and if I could have the elders come forward, past, present, future, all the elders come forward. We get to celebrate. Johnny and Christy are going, and the Mall family are going to Awaken Church. They are going with Johnny Mull to be a core team to help plant a church. They have been a core part of Trinity, and so they understand what it means to be core. It wasn't that we wanted to send anybody with them, and when Johnny and Christy asked if they could go and be part of this church plant, we were more than excited for them to go. Not in a bad way. We were more than excited for them to go because the kingdom of God continues. They're going to reach people we cannot. They're going to carry the heart and love that we have here to even further reaches of the corners of Galloway. And so we are so excited that they are going. This is their last Sunday. I say last Sunday. They'll be here. They're not going anywhere. They're not disappearing. They're still. Johnny's still probably going to text you at 3 o'clock every day. They are still part of our family. They are still part of our friends. You will still see me hanging out with them. We will be all together. But we want to send them, and we're going to use them as the representatives of that whole church. And we're going to pray over you, and we're going to send you. So would you guys come on up, and elders, would you come forward? For those of you who may be new or don't know, Johnny's probably the person I've known longer here at Trinity. Actually, longer other than my mom and dad. I've known him. He has been my closest friend here for the longest. And I got to meet Christy when they got married and she came down. And she has been my right hand in everything. Actually, whatever you would call part of my brain as well. She has signed more things than I have for me. She has just been an incredible part. And it is a good day to send them into ministry as they help minister to us through this hard time. It's not lost on me that God had you here this week. And this didn't happen next week when we didn't have you to help walk us through this. So I want to thank you guys for being part of that. But I also want to say go. Go into this world with excitement, with enthusiasm, with renewed energy and passion, and grow that church beyond the borders of Trinity. And do amazing, amazing things. God is going to go with you. So we're going to lay our hands on you. And Rory, will you pray for them?
Heavenly Father, Lord, we come before you now, Lord, with praise. Lord, even through mourning at time, Lord, we do want to see that light. We do want to see the opportunities we have to praise you with, Lord.
Amen.
And this is one of those times, Lord, as we have your servants up here, John and Christy, Lord, that have served you in so many ways, that have loved you, that have sacrificed their time and energy for you, Lord. We as a church want to thank you and praise you for them and for what they have done here at Trinity Alliance, Lord. Lord, we pray now as they move on and as they have felt led, Lord, we thank you that they have heard your calling, Lord. We thank you that they have listened to you.
Amen.
And though we are going to miss them, Lord, and there will be a gap that they have filled here at this church, Lord, we thank you that they are going and they're going to help spread your word beyond these walls, Lord. which we are called to do, each and every one of us, not just to stay in our comfort zone, Lord, not just to do what we want to do, but to hear your call, Lord, and spread the gospel, your light, amongst the world that is so dark, Lord. And we thank you that you have strengthened them and given them that opportunity, Lord, and given them the heart to want to serve you, and in all their ways acknowledge you, Lord, for you direct their paths. We thank you, Lord. We praise you, Lord, for what you have done. You are a good, good God. And there is none like you, Lord. And we thank you that you are a foundation that we can stand on. We thank you that you are a foundation that never changes, that all good gifts that come down, Lord, are from the Father of light. Lord, we just ask that you bless John and Christy, that you bless their family, Lord, that you just bless the ministry that they are going to have, that you just bless the Awakened Church, Lord, that John Moll has started, Lord, in hearing your call, that it succeeds, Lord, that you just not allow Satan to get in there, Lord, and try to destroy that which you are building, Lord. Your church will stand, Lord. Your word will stand. And your word never comes back void, so whatever goes out, Lord, you will see that the seed is planted. Lord, we give you all the praise and honor and glory because you are the one deserving of it. You are the one to be honored because you are so good, Lord, to us. And we thank you for it. So go with us today. Go with John and Christy as they move on, Lord, that you will just continue to allow our eyes to be open to you, Lord. And when we face those trials, as James and Peter says that we will, that we are not shaken and we are not moved because we are on the foundation, Lord, that holds us together. Lord, again, we thank you. Again, we praise you, Lord. May your name be glorified in all ways. In your name, amen.
Thank you, guys. Love you. One other thing I want to do, just stay right here, big guy. One other thing I want to do to celebrate things that are happening in the church, Rory got licensed as a pastor a few weeks ago. He is on a 3-year track to work through for ordination and for full licensure, but we just want to celebrate. He is no longer just Rory. He is now Pastor Rory, and so let's give it up for what God's doing in him. I could not be more proud and more excited. I want to cover two other things before we go. The service, it looks like, will be on Wednesday, will be the visitation here at Trinity. We are expecting probably close to 2,000 people walking through here. Anytime a young person has passed away and somebody as well-loved, I want you to know there's about 2,000 what people will call themselves Jonathan's best friends coming through, because everyone was Jonathan's best friend. If you knew him, was to be your best friend. So they will be here. It is an opportunity for all of Trinity to minister to a community. They're coming here. So we will be coming together to minister. Keep an eye on the emails and all the other posts so that you can know how you can minister. We are going to need people who are going to help usher. We're going to need just people here in the crowd to pray with and hold people who are hurting. Shannon, we really could use you if you'll be around. We will have that. So that's from 5 to 7. I think that's wishful thinking. But 5 to 7 on Wednesday. Thursday, the service will be here at 5. And we will pull together. I'm not sure what we're doing for repast or food or how that's all gonna work. That hasn't been worked out yet. But we know when the services are. So be ready. We're going to pull together as a family, as a church, and we're going to serve this community that's coming here. And I want to thank you for that. There's two different, or a handful of different opportunities to be able to share with Eric and Sherry. I know when it comes to something, especially suicide and grief, one of the things that's hurtful is people do avoid people who are hurting in that way because we don't know what to say. It's natural to kind of just be like, well, I'm not sure what to say. I'm just going to say something stupid, right? Because what do you say to them? How are you doing? You know, that doesn't work. You know, time heals all wounds. You know, there's nothing you can say that's going to take any of that away. But an I love you and a hug will always do. They're asking, they want to share their grief with the world and with the whole family. And a lot of times when they went through this with Dylan, they had a lot of really awesome things that you people put together and sent them, but it wasn't available to the world. So what they're saying is, will you please, if you're going to reach out to them through Johnny's Facebook or Instagram and post on there. So if you have pictures, if you have a word of encouragement, a verse, a song that you want to send them, they're monitoring them. But this way, the whole family gets it, and all of their friends and the people who don't know Jesus, they get to see the response. So please, if you would like to reach out to them, the best way to reach out to them is through the Instagram or Facebook. I think it's under Jonathan Christopher. It's not really Whitmer, but you'll find him if you type in Whitmer. But it's under Jonathan Christopher, which was his middle name. So you can reach out to him that way. We're doing kind of our own version of that here. Jenna has put out there little note cards, and we're asking that you bring in pictures. We would like to put together a notebook of encouragement and verses and stories and pictures so that the nieces and nephews who don't have an opportunity to remember him will have something that they can flip through to be able to minister to them years from now. So this is an opportunity to reach out to them. So please bring in your pictures, write in your encouraging words, what Johnny meant to you. Put those on the cards. We'll be doing that for the next two Sundays, so you have an opportunity to do that, but you'll see it on the bench out there. Did I miss anything on that? Okay. I think that's all I have for you, so let me pray for you. Oh, the last thing I wanted to tell you, how sabbatical is going to work from here? I don't know. Please call me. I'm here. I'm definitely not on sabbatical this week. I'm definitely not missing and unavailable to you. I don't know. I have to talk with the elders of how this is all going to look. I'm not going to preach every Sunday. I'm not sure how everything is going to look from here. It all depends on how much I am needed here. And I told the ministry team on Friday when we met, I told them, I said, listen, I'm not back because you need me. You were doing an incredible job without me. You have leaders that could walk you through this, who could preach a 10 times better sermon than I could to help walk you through. I needed to be here with you. This was more for me than for me to be here with you. This church can handle this on their own, but I didn't want to miss it. So I selfishly came back to be part of this. This is not at all, oh, I've got to come back, and not at all. I just want to be here with you. My heart's hurting. I want to be with my family. Mm-hmm. And I needed to be here. So I appreciate you allowing me and the teaching team to let me step back in. And I just want to let you know, we'll announce what we're doing kind of sabbatical-wise and when stop, you know, don't text me this week or whatever. But for now, please reach back out. I miss you, and I need you. And I know we need each other. So I'm here. So don't play the game of, well, I'm not going to reach out to him. He's not around. I am. We need each other in this. Let's pray. God, I just thank you for the opportunity to pray for them to end this service, to pray for this congregation who truly does love you. God, I pray if there's anybody here who doesn't know you, Lord, I pray that you would show them your goodness, your faithfulness, and their need for you. And that, Lord, they don't need some special word. They don't need some light to shine on them. But, Lord, that they just need to trust you and to choose to trust you today. Lord, I pray that you would draw their hearts to you that they might accept you and believe in you. You are an amazing God. Lord, for those who are hurting, Lord, I pray for the next little bit of time that we're going to be praying for one another, that you would bring things that are in the darkness to light. Lord, move all of this junk out of the shadows and into the light where it can be healed, where truth can speak to it, and that the lies can no longer devour. Father, you are an amazing God, and I praise you. Holy Spirit, will you come and continue to minister to us throughout this week? Father, as always, we need you, but we see it so clearly today. Help us to rally as a church together, and I praise you that Trinity is the best church I know to surround each other. God, you are amazing. Thank you for your Spirit. I thank you for your Son who died for us, for your Spirit who ministers to us, and for a God who has an amazing plan. We thank you. You are good. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You are invited to come forward and to pray with one another. I am going to ask Tyler, can you just play a little quietly on the guitar? If you want prayer, please come forward. You are more than welcome to hang and talk. We probably need to, but please do that out in the foyer while we are ministering with one another here in prayer. And don't hesitate to just stop and pray for each other. Thank you so much for this morning. I needed it. Have a blessed week, and I will get hold of you this week as to what we need to do. Thank you. I will see you guys next Sunday.